sins, with all the children of your holy church, we glorify and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Church and her children.
Shant, Adi, Adi, Adi,
shout with joy from the mountains. Sunday is a feast so great. Offer praise to the Lord God, and with angels celebrate.
Blessed be God.
Brothers and sisters, because of this, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus for you Gentiles, if I suppose you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for your benefit, namely, that the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly earlier. When you read this, you can understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to human beings in other generations, as it now has been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body, and co-partners in the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this, I became a minister by the gift of God's grace that was granted me in accord with the existence of his power. To me, the very least of all the holy ones, this grace was given, to preach to the Gentiles the inscrutable riches of Christ and to bring light for all. What is the plan of mystery hidden from ages past in God who created things, so that the manifold of wisdom of God might now be made known through the church and to the principalities and authorities in the heavens? This was according to the eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness of speech and confident of access through the faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over my afflictions for you. This is your glory.
Praise be to God always.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be
Alleluia.
Lord, the honor of the Most Holy Trinity. This is
before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior, announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy.
Peace be with you.
The
gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew, who proclaimed life to the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. listen and give glory and thanks to the word of the living God.
The Apostle Matthew writes, Jesus went from that place, and he withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, the Canaanite woman of that district came and called out, Have pity on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon. But he did not say a word in answer to her. His disciples came and asked him, Send her away, Lord, for she keeps calling out after us. And he said in reply, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But the woman came and did him homage, saying, Lord, help me. And he said in reply, It is not right to take the food of the children and to throw it to the dogs. And she said, Please, Lord, for even the pups eat the scraps that fall from the table of their masters. Then Jesus said to her in reply, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God. For giving us his words of life. Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God.
Yes, Lord, yet even the puppies eat the crumbs that fall from the Master's table. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This gospel episode is among one of the most surprising, if not shocking, in the gospel. Here we have the event where God himself, the Messiah, ignores this poor woman in the crowd, and then when she keeps persisting on coming to him, basically calls her a dog. This is shocking. In fact, it's not just shocking to our complacent 20th century ears. It was shocking even to the apostles. In the parallel text in the other two gospels of Mark and Luke, Mark, in telling the story, cuts out the whole section of our Lord saying, I have come only for the lost sheep of Israel, and the whole episode in which our Lord says to her, it's not fitting to take the food from the children and to throw it to dogs. That whole section, St. Mark doesn't even record. He talks about the Canaanite woman and the healing. And as far as St. Luke, who's also the other author, Mark and Luke are the two authors who are writing for both basically a non-Israelite community. St. Luke doesn't even record the episode. This place takes place in the area of Tyre and Sidon, which is now southern Lebanon. So these people are not Israelites at all. And not only is this woman not an Israelite, we are told explicitly that she's a Canaanite. And a Canaanite means that she is a part of the people who are the ancestral enemies of the people of Israel for the last 1,000 years. And so this woman stands, anyone hearing this Gospel of St. Matthew is written primarily for those converts who come from Israel. So that's why for them it would have been less shocking to hear that the Christ has only come for the lost sheep of Israel. To them that makes perfect sense. And to use the prophetic imagery of the food of the children being given to dogs, also a very prophetic imagery, or an image of the prophets, that wouldn't have shocked them. But still, for us, we see it's really quite extraordinary, this event, as it's recorded. Now, in the translation that we have, it is written in the Missal, it talks about the woman's response when she answers is saying, yes, but even the dogs also receive crumbs from their master's table. They will sit by and wait for something given to them. But in fact, the term which she's using is little dogs, like puppies. So not only is it not a dog, but I'm just this little insignificant thing in its immaturity, in its littleness, waiting for Christ to be given to her. And so she uses, and the response is part of the reason why our Lord extols her. Now, as the Fathers write of our Lord and the work of the redemption of mankind, they speak of our Lord as the divine physician, the one who comes and brings the divine medicine, which is his passion, in order to heal the human race. And so what we have in the Gospel today is an example of how this healing takes place and also how it will spread beyond just simply Israel. So as recorded even for the people, for the Gospel of St. Matthew, they are being taught, these Israelite conversions, converts, they are being taught that this gospel and this healing is going to spread to more than just simply you. The Canaanite woman demonstrates then how this divine medicine is administered. And in this instance, we see very clearly, it is cauterization. Grace cuts and it burns. And there's a reason for it. We'll come back to it in a moment. What St. John Chrysostom says of the Canaanite woman in this episode is that she signifies, she exemplifies the contrite sinner. When we use the word contrition or contrite, contrition in the Latin literally means to be broken. And so when we speak about contrition, we're saying, I recognize the brokenness in the choices and decisions that I have made in my life. They are insufficient. Not only are they insufficient, they are broken, and they have broken me and broken those around me and have broken my relationship with God. That is contrition. And so this Canaanite woman coming, she exemplifies, as St. John Chrysostom says, the contrite sinner who relies completely, 100%, upon divine mercy. There is no complacency, there is no smugness, there is no self-sufficiency in her confession. I am in complete and utter dependence upon divine mercy. And so the contrite sinner begs in their self-understanding of their brokenness, they beg in their own human frailty. That's what this woman is doing. She may be a Canaanite, and she may be a pagan living in the southern parts of what's now Lebanon, but she knows enough about Israel to refer to this man, this rabbi of Nazareth, as being Lord. And she knows enough of Israel and the law of Moses to refer to him as the son of David, which is a messianic title for the Christ. So when she approaches, she's not just simply dependent. She is realizing that there is something more than just a miracle to be accomplished. There is a realization of heaven in this man, the son of David. And of course, that when our Lord simply ignores her and walks by, being the good woman that she is, she keeps calling out after him to the point where the apostles come and tell our Lord, please, just get rid of her. She keeps shouting after us. This is annoying. And that's when she realized this kind of communication, I won't say altercation, but the apostles are frustrated. Get rid of this pagan woman. And when she comes up and she says, help me, Lord. And that's when our Lord then gives this answer of the food of the children not being given to dogs. It is teaching us that in the contrition of sin, that only the humble can be healed. It's only when we've been stripped off that self-complacency, that healing is possible for us. So her healing only takes place after she's been, to our ears, severely rebuked and insulted. And that's when the phrase which I use at the beginning of the sermon is when she says, but guess what, but even the puppies get crumbs. Please. That's our Lord's reaction by marveling at her faith. Now, as I've told you often, the word faith doesn't mean just theological, I believe in what's revealed. The word faith has a much larger understanding of confidence, of loyalty, and of perseverance. We are faithful to members in our family. We have reasons to remain attached to them, even when they do stupid things. And so what this woman is demonstrating, even in the face of rebuke, is this perseverance. And that's why our Lord, we are told, marvels, and he says, "Great is your faith, woman. Let it be done unto you as you wish." And we're told at that very moment, her daughter, who had been under the influence of the demonic, is freed and healed. Now, I mentioned to you one of the reasons this cauterization, this cutting and burning that takes place with grace, is something which I wrote up in the bulletin when I first came in the month of May. Is that when grace is given, the divine medicine that comes from Calvary, there is no salvation that comes outside of the Christ. The work of God is accomplished in his divine Son. There is no salvation, there is no ultimate beatitude of the vision of God outside of Christ. Everything flows from Calvary. And because it all flows from Calvary and the incarnate Word, that this theophany, this appearance of God in history, which is our Lord Jesus Christ, this theophany of the life, death, and resurrection of the Messiah means that salvation and grace is stamped, it is sealed, it is marked with the image of the cross simultaneous with the life that it gives of redemption. So that when grace enters our lives, grace is beautiful, grace is joyous, and grace is triumphant, but it is simultaneously that which flows from Calvary. It always has the mark of the cross and the mark of the suffering and death of the Messiah upon it. And therefore it always cuts and it burns. And this remains true even when we are faithful. In fact, we can say, indeed, it is often even truer when we are faithful, because we are entering more and more and more into the kingdom, into that grace. And therefore, the more that we are entering into that life of God, of grace, it also means that we're entering into that grace which is marked with the sign of the cross. And that is ultimately what this episode in the inspired gospel is telling us about the Canaanite woman. The closer she is getting to the redemption and the healing of her daughter, the more she is, in a sense, buffeted by our Lord himself. Not because he intends to humiliate and hurt her, any more than a surgeon who's doing cardiac surgery on you really wants to break your ribcage and bruise you and psychologically send you over the bend because you've been dead on this operating table. That's not their intention, but it is part of the cutting and the burning that is necessary to arrive at health. The Canaanite woman is ultimately the perfect example for us of when things don't go the way you expect. That rabbi did not turn around and say, "Fine, your daughter's healed, let's go on." No, he tries her, he pulls her in, and he makes her a greater woman at the end of this episode than she was in the beginning. But the meantime was precisely this cauterization, cutting, and burning. Now, I wanted to bring it up to you just for us to finish with, because last week the question came up, and Father didn't deal with Fatima in August of 1917 last week, which would have been mid-month. Because in fact, in August of 1917, the Mother of God did not appear to the children on August 13th. So this is an example to make an application of the Canaanite woman, and that grace of life is always marked by the cross, is to give you a few details about these children, of what is happening to this 7-year-old, this 9-year-old, and this 10-year-old. These little children, talk about puppies. These children that are brought, first of all, is the detail that when all these people arrive in July of 1917, the 3,000 people or so, they've trampled over all of the fields of Lucia's father.
Her family in 1917, that summer, were brought to the brink of starvation because they lost their crops and the food for their family. Now, did the Mother of God not know that? She chose to appear there, in those fields. It is part of the message of Fatima. The clothes that these children are being prepared in 1916, the year before, by the angel of peace, the angel of Portugal, the angel of the Eucharist. In being prepared, these children are moved. That is beauty and light the year before. But coming the next year, as we move towards the miracle of October of 1917, these children are now given to participate in this glory of the grace which is marked by the cross. And that first detail is that her family is brought to the brink of starvation that year. Now, the reason why the apparition does not take place on August 13th in 1917 is because the children were kidnapped. The governor of the area in 1917 was a Mason, was a Freemason. Anti-Catholic, he wanted these, in his opinion, shenanigans to stop. And literally hours before the apparition on August 13th, he kidnaps the children. He deceives their fathers, and he has them sent away. And as he comes to the crossroads to go to the cove, he takes the opposite direction and returns to the capital with the children, with the fathers watching their children being kidnapped. This man takes these children and locks them in his house on August 13th. 7-year-old, a 9-year-old, and a 10-year-old. Now, his wife is more or less a practicing Catholic, as practicing as you can be with an anti-Catholic Mason that you're married to. So she tries to treat them nicely for that night. But the following day, on the 14th of August, this man takes these children, threatens them with death if they do not reveal the secret told to them in July, that he will kill them by having them boiled in oil. But what happens on the day of August 13th? Because at that event, there were 6,000 people that appeared. So they doubled the number from July, and when they arrive there, of course, there's no apparition, the children aren't there. What the people see is a kind of cloud appear over the shrub, and then it evaporates. Nothing else happens. Except that as the cloud evaporates, everyone realizes that the colors have changed. And they talk about it being like a rainbow, that the trees that were around looked like they had jewels in them instead of leaves, because the leaves were all variety of colors of the rainbow. And that the people's faces and their clothing shone with this kind of multicolored rainbow light before everything ceased. That's the only thing that happened on August 13th. And while the children the following day are taken by this man, and they are thrown into a prison cell with all of these grown adults, these men, these thieves, these prisoners who are there, these criminals, they take these little children and they throw them into prison. He throws them into prison. Needless to say, the prisoners are completely shocked to see these two little girls and this little boy thrown in amongst them. And needless to say, the children are absolutely terrified. Their parents are not there, they don't know what's going on, and this grown adult is telling them, I am going to kill you. You will be put to death if you do not tell me what the secret was told to you last month. And the children do not budge. So what he winds up doing that day is he takes the children, one by one, and he says, if you don't tell the secret, we will now take you and you will be boiled. We have oil glowing. And they had these soldiers who came in who were even more brutal, making fun of the fact that you're now going to die, and dragging these children out to their death. And the children would not tell the secret from July. And after they went one by one, Lucille was left alone in this room, absolutely certain that her cousins had just been put to death. She's 10. She's in fourth grade. She is a little girl. And then he tells her, if you do not tell this secret, you too will die. And she will not tell what the lady from heaven had told her. And so he has perjured her. Now, obviously, when she arrives in the room, she finds her cousins alive. So they go from absolute desolation to jubilation. And what happens then is when he realizes that nothing is going to break these children, he takes them back to his home. And on the Feast of the Assumption of the Mother of God, August 15th, the children are let out. When they return home, he takes them back, acting like nothing had happened, like he's good buddies with his family friend for years. And he brings the children home, leaves them there, and goes back to the capital. The children, having been shaken up in this moment of grace and crucifixion, they go out and they continue to do their work of pasturing the animals, the sheep. And it's on the Sunday, August 19th, so literally a year ago yesterday, when they are in the fields, it's Lucia and it's Francisco, and Francisco's older brother John, but Jacinta's not there. And there is a change in the atmosphere, which looks at first like a storm, and then Francisco and Lucia realize that the Mother of God is going to appear. So they tell John, you run back home and get Jacinta and bring her back. And as Jacinta arrives, there's the flash of light, and the cloud appears, and even though they're not in the cold, the Mother of God appears to the children. So that we have this mark of the cross, this light of grace, and she reminds them again to pray the rosary each day. That there will be a miracle in October to prove what I have been saying is true. And then Lucia approaches the Mother of God and she says, people have left money here. What are we supposed to do with this? And the Mother of God told her, you save this money because you will use it as part to begin to build a chapel here. And then lastly, Our Lady tells them again, you must pray and make reparation for sin. She tells the children that many sinners go to hell because no one has prayed for them. And with that, you have again the passage to the east, and the fading out of this light of the woman of life. So August is a moment showing us this movement of the children to a very special miracle of the grace which is both life and crucifixion. So that the Canaanite woman has given us an example which we see living in the three children of Fatima. May they all intercede for us, obtain for us the strength to see, to embrace that grace, and enter more fully into the kingdom of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We believe in one God,
Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before
etaniunt, venium silvo taiva toche, unel baitoches unel chayetlo,
spiritual day.
make it for us. Accept the offering of this bloodless sacrifice and grant us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with pure hearts and divine love, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
One of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Wabyamo habadaktam harsha dilema venha.
so danzi quomen hamro quomen praio. Ore pro corden, qui avet adida coronor, sabes tamen ne purpur.
Upon them,
For you are good and rich in graces, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, civil leaders throughout the world, that they may all stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, O Lord. Especially those of Charlottesville and Barcelona and the rest of the world, shed your compassion and grace upon them all, so that your light and guidance may bring them to overcome ignorance and hatred. May your divine charity bring them all into the fullness of your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord. Especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, St. Joseph, St. Jude, and St. Maron, St. Charbel, and all the saints, assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord. Sufferings for the sake of your church and your people, may we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to their rest, hoping in you, while waiting their life-giving voice calling them to life. Accept the offerings we present to you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed.
Glorified in us and in all things, with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, it shall be forever. Amen.
Those who trespass against us, and lead us not into
do not forsake us lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us bow our heads before the God of mercy, before this forgiving altar, and before the body and the blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries with purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy, and we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and asking for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for your life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, we raise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. Lord, we of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord. My Jesus Christ, O Lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Oh,
Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name, that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself you saved us. Deliver us from damnation and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.